So why does the Bible matter? I'm going to begin with a related topic. In our theology, we have the idea of God as immanent, as within all of us, as the ultimate ground of existence. Now, if you have that idea, then you might think that democracy is a good idea, where the views of everyone are taken into consideration, and presidents and other officials are given their power from the people. And also, if you see God in everyone, you might see different religions as just different ways of getting to God. Just like if someone likes pop music, they can at least appreciate that classical music or the music of India or Africa is still music. They might not like it. It might not be to their taste, but they could acknowledge it's music. And therefore, with the idea of an immanent God, we could have freedom of religion. We wouldn't favor one religion over another. However, let's suppose we have the idea of a transcendental God who is a person, so our Father who art in heaven. Now, since God is transcendental and beyond human understanding, then the only way for us to get to know that God would be if that God revealed himself, either in the person of someone, such as Jesus, or in Scripture. Scripture is just a record of either what a God-man did, as in the case of Jesus, or what an inspired prophet said, which is what Moses and Muhammad are believed to have been. It would be natural also around those writings to have a priesthood that knows how to interpret them, because the writings may be ambiguous and have things that are easily misunderstood. Now, heaven is a hierarchy, so there's God at the top. Below him, in the medieval times, he used to believe that I think there were 9 levels of angels. But sooner or later, it gets down to this world. And it was thought that God gave authority to the king to rule. Catholic Church at one point had the idea of the divine right of kings. And the Catholic Church used to coronate kings as if God was giving the authority through the cleric, through the pope or cardinal, to the king. And in a monarchy, the people's will really doesn't matter that much. As a practical matter, you might have to keep them somewhat happy so they don't rebel. But really, king's authority comes from God, then that's all that matters, is what the king wants. So that this kind of society is hierarchical, and the stratification may continue where there's one favored race and other races are looked down upon, or perhaps men look down on women. Whereas when God is seen in everyone, then it's easier to see all people, all races, all genders as essentially equal. Well, the title of this clip is Why the Bible Matters, and I think we've arrived at an answer now. The Bible supports the priesthood, which claims authority from God, and religion usually supports state. Augustine, about 1600 years ago, described the dogma of a just war. But since that time, no major Christian denomination that I know of has ever declared a war unjust and forbidden its followers to fight in that war under pain of sin. So effectively, Augustine's dogma of a just war gave a rubber stamp to religion to approve any and all wars. So in the Second World War, Italian Americans from the United States fought Italians in Italy, and German Americans from the United States fought Germans in Italy, and maybe a Lutheran German fought American Lutheran German, and Lutheran Catholic fought American Lutheran Catholic. And apparently that war was just for both sides, because no church declared it unjust. The idea of a book and a clergy give various benefits to the state. As we've seen, they give legitimacy to the ruler and legitimacy to war often. And the idea of a religious congregation, I think, helps promote uniformity among the citizens who are given a set of things to believe and are taught to accept what clergy says over what their own eyes tell them. And that's a very useful habit for state, especially if state wants to engage in unjust wars or other unjust practices. It can, with authority, declare those practices somehow just, and their statements will be accepted by a large percentage of the population. So religion where there is a transcendental God who is a person and a scripture, such religions tend to support the state. In return, the state gives privileges to religion. In the United States, religions don't have to pay any taxes. There are various financial records that they don't have to reveal to the government. In the United States, many states have a law that specifically protect parents who allow their children to die for religious reasons. The parents can't be prosecuted. So a religious family has a sick child and could even be a disease that's easily cured in a hospital. But they don't go to a hospital. They pray instead and put their faith in prayer over medicine. The child dies and they cannot be prosecuted for any crime. So religion is given privileges by the state, and in return, it reinforces the state. Now, were there only one religion, one book, and one set of clergy, the case could be made, look how God has wonderfully provided for us, how God has ordained our government, and how the universe is solidified. It's organized with God influencing government and customs and telling us what's right or wrong. Well, first of all, scriptures disagree with each other. Christianity believes that Jesus is the Son of God. Islam believes that Jesus is a prophet, but not God, because in Islam, God neither begets nor is begotten. But even if we limit ourselves to Christianity and the Bible, we see that different Christian groups disagree, even about something as fundamental as how to be saved. They have fundamental disagreements, contradictory views. So the multiplicity of these contrary scriptures or contrary interpretations of a single scripture, I believe, show that religions based on suggest that religions based on transcendental persons are useful to the state, and that accounts for their prevalence and popularity. That accounts for why religious people will indoctrinate their children when the children are even 4 and 5 years old. So that accounts for the popularity of such religion. But it also argues against the validity and truth of such religion because of the different interpretations in the different scriptures. So it could be said, perhaps, that religions based on gods who are persons who transcend the universe, religions that believe in the supernatural, that have a scripture, it could be said that if they have validity and are not entirely bogus, they have a somewhat limited validity. We know they can't all be true. We know that because they contradict each other. So even though they provide services to the state, I mean, there are countries that are theocracies where there's one official religion. And even other countries are very dominated often by religion. So religion provides for the state. The state provides for religion. It's a very nice symbiotic relationship. Religion is very prevalent, of the type where there's an external God who is a person. But I think we cannot say it's true. Now, maybe the religion based on an impersonal, immanent God, as we're developing in this theology of ours, is true, or at least truer, and maybe not. Thanks for listening. As an afterthought, it's been said at various times in the past that weapons were developed that were so terrible, so destructive, that they all but guaranteed that they could not be used, and therefore that peace was at hand. Here are some examples. And today, we say much the same thing about nuclear weapons. Religion, as we've seen, at least Western religion, has not been good at stopping wars. If we were to list all the wars in Western Europe, say, over the past 1,000 years, there'd be very many of them.
Of the explosion, we were wearing Polaroid welder's glasses. They were so dark that even the tropical sun showed through them as nothing more than a vague pinpoint of light. Even then, the explosion, when eventually it came, was so bright that it had the same effect as if night had been turned into day. We looked out towards the target and saw a vast ball of fire. It was about 2,000 feet in the air and half a mile in diameter. This fire, which generated almost 10 million degrees of heat, began rocketing up into the heavens at a speed of something like 20,000 feet a minute.
So, probably can't depend on existing religions to curb nations' appetite for war, especially since, for instance, Christianity hit the big time, so to speak, when Rome, the Roman Empire, made it its official religion. So many religions today were intimately involved with the creation or the sustaining of empire, and they have an approval of war kind of built into their DNA. Could a different theology lead to different religions that are better at preventing war? I don't know, but it's a thought.